The next item of business is a personal statement by Humza Yousaf. There should be no interventions or interruptions, and I call on Humza Yousaf.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to make a final statement from the front benches. It gives me the opportunity to put on record some thanks to several people who have supported me on the incredible journey that I've been blessed to be on over the last 12 years as a minister in the government. I will say no more about my wonderful family, partly because there are really no words to convey my love for them for putting up with me over the last 12 years and beyond, but also because I did promise my 15-year-old that I wouldn't embarrass her again by crying on national television. So my thanks, first of all, are to you, Presiding Officer, and those who preceded you for the fairness that you have shown me during my time on the front benches. I, of course, intend on repaying that fairness by being a model backbencher who will be on their best behaviour. I don't believe the opposition are laughing. Who will be on their best behaviour, at least, Presiding Officer, for the first few weeks anyway. Many of us, I think, will be in a reflective mood as we mark 25 years of devolution this week. I'm certain that I'm not the only one who reread over Donald Dewar's historic and remarkable opening speech when this Parliament was reconvened. And there are many lines that could be quoted, but one in particular stood out for me this week. And I quote, "This is about more than our politics and our laws. This is about who we are and how we carry ourselves." And in that vein, let me offer thanks to every single colleague across the political divide for the kindnesses you have shown me over the years. We often, and I'm guilty of this too, lament the toxic nature of our political debate. And it's true, there is an entrenched tribalism that feels difficult to free ourselves from. However, I will remember far more fondly the kindness and generosity of colleagues over the years. I got to witness that kindness when I made my first ever speech to this chamber on the 2nd of June 2011. After making my speech, a certain one, Tavish Scott, shortly followed with his own contribution thereafter. And he addressed me directly and said, "If that is the standard of your first speech, I cannot wait for the next one and the next one and the next one." I suspect Tavish Scott didn't quite expect me to drone on for as long as I have. However, that one compliment, that one moment of kindness from a very senior MSP in this Parliament made me feel 10 feet tall. It cost Tavish Scott nothing, yet settled this very nervous 26-year-old new entrant to the chamber and gave me a confidence to ensure that I bettered myself. So what I'm really trying to say, Presiding Officer, this is all Tavish Scott's fault. No, I jest, of course. I've had many such instances of kindness over the years from my own SNP colleagues and to those right across the political spectrum. They've come at some of the most difficult times in my life, for example, when my in-laws were recently trapped in Gaza. But they've also come at times of great celebration, for example, when my daughter Amal was born 5 years ago. The purpose of mentioning this is to remind myself and others, I hope, that kindness costs us nothing. Being good to one another costs us nothing. Being compassionate to one another costs us nothing, yet can, quite literally, make a whole world of difference. So for all the kindness shown to me by colleagues over the years, thank you. Presiding Officer, let me also take this moment to thank the incredible civil service for their unwavering dedication to our country. I cannot possibly thank every member of my private office over the years, or indeed all the civil servants I've had the great pleasure of working closely with. But I am so grateful to each and every one of them for their support over the years. There are sections of our society, our politics, our media, who enjoy denigrating civil servants, who see them as an easy target. And such lazy commentary is often so far from the truth. Our civil servants work tirelessly for their country, not seeking the limelight, but quietly and diligently getting on with the job of serving Scotland, often going above and beyond the call of duty. And for that, they have my eternal thanks and my admiration. Presiding Officer, I have had the greatest privilege of my life serving my country and government for almost 12 years. As Minister for External Affairs and International Development, Minister for Transport, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, and of course, most recently, as First Minister. So my thanks must go to the people who gave me that opportunity by electing me to this place, the good people of Glasgow in 2011 and the fine people of Glasgow Pollock since 2016, who've continued to put their trust in me to stand up for them and to serve them. And also to my predecessors as First Minister, for giving this boy opportunities he could only have imagined in his wildest dreams. I'm grateful for the trust that you put in me over the years. Because you see, Presiding Officer, young Humza Yousaf could never have imagined that he would be able to lead this country. I was 6 years old when I was first told to go home. And I'm afraid since then it's been a regular occurrence. In fact, almost daily if you look at my social media feeds. And I won't lie, Presiding Officer, it is that racial slur that probably hurts me the most. Very simply, because I have no other home than this one. I never will. I never have. My heart will forever belong to Scotland. So to have the opportunity to defy the far right, to defy the racists, to defy the bigots who told me to go home, but be in a position to serve my home, to contribute to public life in my home, and to have had the opportunity to lead my home, well, that has been the most tremendous honour that I didn't think was reserved for people who looked like me. And there I have broken my promise to my 15-year-old daughter. I hope that from my example, other little boys and girls who look or sound different know that it is our differences which make us unique that should be celebrated as part of a modern and diverse Scotland, and that in no way should that ever, those differences ever hold you back from achieving your dreams. And lastly, to my successor, to my dear friend, John Swinney. John is one of the most empathetic, kind, compassionate people that I've had the pleasure of knowing over the years. Such qualities are crucial in life. They are absolutely necessary as First Minister. I remember Nicola Sturgeon saying to me that as First Minister, you get to make someone's day every single day in office. I'm also quite possibly making somebody's day by leaving office, I suspect, too. However, I can testify that Nicola Sturgeon was absolutely right. You can make someone's day through the smallest act of kindness, stopping for a selfie with someone, or through transformative policy like the Scottish Child Payment. The privilege of serving the people of Scotland through this office never gets tiring. I know John will do his family proud, he will do our party proud, and he will do our nation proud as he dedicates his life to the service of Scotland, the country we are all proud to call home and that we all love so dearly. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I will take some time to refamiliarise myself with the backbenches, as I intend on being an active contributor to this Parliament, as my constituents, of course, would expect me to be. And I will continue to champion those issues that are close to my heart, ensuring that I give a voice to the voiceless, be they at home or indeed overseas. And in that vein, I cannot let today's remarks go by without pleading one last time from the front benches for the international community to stop any further massacre of the innocent people of Gaza, a full-scale invasion of Rafah, home to 1.4 million people, 600,000 children, will only result in the slaughter of more innocent civilians and what is likely to be one of the clearest violations of international law to date. A clear signal must be sent to the Israeli government that to defy the international community in this way will come with significant consequence and sanction. Everything possible must be done to demand an immediate ceasefire, a release of all the hostages, and an end to arms sales to Israel. We must be on the right side of history, and that must mean standing with innocent men, women and children. To do otherwise would be unforgivable. Presiding Officer, my time as First Minister is now over. However, I am absolutely certain that for the rest of my life, every Thursday at 11:55, in the afternoon, that my palms will begin to sweat and that knot in my stomach will tighten. That comes, Presiding Officer, from a place of a deep respect for this Parliament and to all of those in opposition, and indeed to my own colleagues here alongside me. That respect will always continue to be there. I hope we can all live up to the hopes of the founding fathers and mothers of devolution and work together in the interest of the common good, the interest of the common weal, and do so with kindness. Thank you, Presiding Officer. It has been an honour and a privilege.
Thank you. Thank you. And on behalf of the Parliament, I thank Humza Yousaf for his service as First Minister, and I suspend this meeting until 3 p.m.